Okay, so let's continue. We looked at the exercise solution of that. We saw that the effect of overhead is actually to increase the pipeline cycle, right? And the overhead is contributed by various factors. So far, are there any difficulties? The ones that we discussed just in the last lecture, are there any? Yes.
Pipeline is achieved by doing assembly operations during memory operations.
We'll see exactly how a pipeline, the instruction pipeline, what are the operations that are carried out in the different stages. Because we said that efficient balancing of the pipeline stages is necessary. See, his question pertains to what are the operations carried out when there is a memory operation occurring. So, my answer to that is that there are various ways a instruction pipeline can be designed as it is being designed in various processors. For example, the Pentium pipeline would be very different from the MIPS pipeline. Even the Pentium 4 pipeline would be different from the Pentium 3 pipeline, right? So, we will see how the what are the different activities performed during the different pipeline stages. Just I think in couple of minutes we will look at an example, the MIPS processor. Later we will look at the Pentium processor and so on. Any other question? Anyone has any difficulty about what we discussed just in the last lecture? Okay, that's good. So that means everybody has understood what we discussed. So now let's proceed further. So we said that pipeline hazards can be a severe drag on performance. If we don't address them, it will render the pipeline useless. It will be even worse than a sequential processor. The hazards can be defined as any situation which can result in incorrect operation of the pipeline. And hazard is any situation which can result in incorrect operation of a pipeline. There are three categories of hazards. This again is a very pet question with the interviewers, and when you appear in your comprehensive Viva and so on, very pet question about what is a pipeline hazard, what are the different classes of hazards, give examples of each, how do you resolve these hazards in the modern processors and so on. So, an hazard can result in incorrect operations of the pipeline, and there are three categories here. One is the structural hazard. The structural hazards here, if two instructions that are concurrently under execution, because we said that in a pipeline there is a overlapped execution or a concurrent execution of different instructions, and if two instructions that are undergoing execution, they require the same hardware unit. For example, they might require the cache, or they might require certain register and things like that. So, then there exists a structural hazard. So, one instruction, an example of a structural hazard is one instruction is being fetched, right, and another instruction is either being decoded and its operand is being fetched, right. So, we need to get the data, or a memory operation is occurring. I think that would be a better example. So, one instruction is being fetched and the memory operation is occurring for another instruction. So, if you are having one cache, it can supply only one unit of data per cycle. So, that would result in a structural hazard. On the other hand, a data hazard would occur when one instruction would depend on result of another instruction. For example, if we have a value A that is being computed by one instruction and A is being written by another, is being used by another instruction. Just to give a simple example, if we have A is equal to B plus C and let us say D is equal to A plus 100, right. So, there is a dependency here. This instruction has the operands A and 100, and until this instruction produces A, this instruction cannot start executing, isn't it? So this is an example of a data dependency. We can also have control hazards. When there are branch instructions, so the outcome of the branch would determine which instruction would be executed next, isn't it? If the branch is true, something else will be executed. Branch decision is true, something will be executed. If the branch decision is false, some other instruction will be executed. So we have to postpone fetching an instruction until we know the branch outcome. So this is an example of a control dependency. Now let us define a term called as pipeline interlock. The pipeline interlock refers to whenever we have a pipeline hazard, any kind of hazard, structural, data hazard or control hazard occurring, we just have some hardware which resolves the pipeline, possibly by stalling the pipeline, right? Whenever we use a hardware means to resolve the pipeline hazards, we call it as a pipeline interlock. The hardware that is used to resolve the pipeline hazards is the pipeline interlock. So the interlock hardware should detect whenever a hazard occurs, and then the appropriate stages of the pipeline should be stalled so that the hazard would be resolved. For example, if a memory operation and instruction fetch operation is required in the same cycle, then it might stall the instruction fetch by one cycle. So once the memory operation is complete, the instruction fetch is stopped for one cycle, and then the next instruction will be fetched after a delay of one cycle, right? So let us remember this, that a pipeline interlock is a hardware means to detect and resolve hazards, and the simple technique it adopts is to stall the pipeline. And obviously this will be a very inefficient solution. It will prevent pipeline from producing wrong results, but it will slow down the pipeline considerably, because as we will see further, that the data dependencies, control dependencies, etc., are just too many in a program. You will encounter them at a very high frequency, maybe 2-3 per instruction. And again, if there are the structural hazards, then again, if you stall it, then your pipeline performance will degrade like anything. In our example pipeline that we will study here initially is the MIPS. The MIPS is historically a very popular architecture as far as studies of high performance architectures are concerned, or modern architectures. The influence of MIPS is enormous. As you will see, that if we understand MIPS well, we can understand most of the modern architectures. So the MIPS architecture was the first publicly known implementation of the RISC architectures. It grew out of research at Stanford, and the professors who developed the MIPS computer, the MIPS architecture, they founded a company called as MIPS Computer System. So for temporarily that took leave from the Stanford University, and they founded this company, and they introduced R2000 MIPS processor in 1986, and later they have successively refined this, as we will see. But one unique way in which the company operated was that they do not sell their design. They do not say that, see, you pay us and you take the design and then you hold the patent on that and manufacture and sell it to somebody else. But what they do is they license the design. Say that, see, we have designed it, this is our intellectual property, you can use this and manufacture and pay license fee or royalty. the MIPS has become a hugely successful processor. Even now it is being used. It is used as the IP cores or the building blocks for embedded processor designs. Anybody knows what is an IP core? Because some of you are doing embedded processor design and so on. See, the basic idea behind developing the embedded processors is that there are some core, intellectual property cores. So they just assemble these cores. You can buy or license the IP cores, right? They are available. And you just assemble these IP cores and you get your embedded system. So that way many systems are being developed, as we will see further down in our discussion, that many processors, many systems are being developed this way. So both 32 and 64 basic cores are offered, and the design is licensed as the MIPS 32 and MIPS 64 bit, right. These are commercially very successful, used in many consumer and industrial applications. You can find them, the MIPS cores can be found in many systems that you use. For example, Cisco routers, Linksys routers, cable modems, ADSL modems, smart cards, laser printer engines, set-top boxes, robots, handheld computers, Sony PlayStation 2, Sony PlayStation Portable, so the list goes on. Very large number of systems use the MIPS core. So it's a very important processor, and as I said, that even the other processors, this has very profoundly influenced their development. If we understand MIPS well, we would be in a position to understand the more complex processor. MIPS is a very simple processor, as we'll see. We'll be able to see the more complex processors later on. But one thing is that as far as the cell phones and PDA application, somehow the MIPS has been unable to displace the ARM core. Later we'll look at the ARM core as well. But as far as the cell phones, PDA applications, etc. are concerned, the ARM core is extremely popular as compared to the MIPS core. So the MIPS stands for microprocessor without interlocked pipeline stages. We had seen what is a interlocking means, right? Just now we had seen that interlocking is the hardware means to resolve the pipeline hazards. And we had said that whenever you use a hardware to resolve hazards, the pipeline inherently becomes inefficient because it basically detects the hazards and stalls, right? So they attempted to overcome this problem of pipeline inefficiency, and they said that, see, this is a microprocessor where we will use pipeline stages, but we will not use hardware means for resolving hazards. We'll use other means, and as a result, we'll have a very efficient pipeline. So let's look at the MIPS architecture. It operates on 64-bit data, even though we also saw that it has a 32-bit, which is being commercially sold because some embedded processors, embedded systems need that. But let's look at the 64-bit one. So there are 32 64-bit registers. So 32 registers, a clear symptom of a RISC processor, right? We had seen that the CISC processors like VAX 8600 and so on, that 6 registers, 8 registers for 8086 and so on. It has two caches, just like a RISC architecture. It has a separate instruction and data cache, 128 KB. The instruction size is constant, 32-bit, and the initial MIPS processors achieved one instruction per cycle throughput. Now there are the 32 registers are numbered R0 to R31, but the value of R0 is always 0. You can't store anything other than 0, right? It's by default 0. So then you will ask, what is the use of this register? don't use it for storing anything, it's always zero. But we'll see that they have done something clever here. They're saying that, see, this register would be used as an operand to reduce the number of instructions, because we had said that the RISC machines have a very restricted number of instructions, but still you'll be able to write all kinds of programs. So somehow some of the basic instructions we should be able to implement in terms of other instructions. Let's see how it does. It has a small number of addressing modes. There are only two modes, immediate and displacement modes. Does everybody know about an immediate addressing mode and a displacement mode? Who doesn't know about an immediate mode operand and a displacement mode operand? Is there anyone who doesn't know? Okay, very good. Everybody knows that what is an immediate addressing mode and a displacement mode. So, register indirect is placed by placing a 0 in the displacement field. So, register indirect. So, here the contents of R1 is added with R4 and stored in R4. So, because this is a displacement is 0, it is the contents of R1. Right. So, those who know the displacement mode well, they would know that making the displacement 0 is nothing but it is the register indirect mode. So, it does not have a separate register indirect mode. Similarly, the absolute addressing is by using R0 as the register operand. So, we will see that like that there are many ways in which the addressing modes, the instructions have been reduced. Here is another example. The R0 is used to synthesize popular instructions. For example, in MIPS there is no move instruction. On the other hand, we can use add R3 R0 with immediate 3. So, R0 and R3, R0 is 0, 0 is added with 3 and stored at R3, R3 is the destination, right. The effect of that is to move 3 to R3. There is no separate move instruction needed because this will do the work. Add R3 R0 immediate 3. So, we will see as we look at more number of some programs in MIPS and so on, we will see that R0 helps in reducing the number of instructions and the addressing modes, very required for RISC architecture. The MIPS memory is byte addressable with 64 bit addresses. There are 4 broad classes of instructions: load store instructions, ALU operations, branches and jumps, and floating point operations. So, as far as load store, ALU, branch and jump, it is the same instruction pipeline. As some of you had also asked earlier, that how can we use the load store etcetera in the same instruction pipeline, we will just see that. But one thing is about the floating point operations. See, the floating point operations can take unduly long time. How will that be handled in the pipeline? I think we will just look at that shortly. So, the MIPS pipeline is a 5-stage pipeline. So, we have the instruction fetch, the first stage. Second stage is decode operands and fetch register operands. So, decode and operand fetch, even though we have written ID, it stands for decode operands and fetch the register operands. ALU perform the ALU operation and also the data operand address generation, because sometimes we will have to generate the address of the data operand. We will just look with an, we will just examine that with an example. Memory stage, so here the data memory reference, either read or write, like you are saying that load store, write back into register file or store into the destination register. Yeah, right. Yeah. We will see all those things. We have further discussions coming up on that. So this just introduces a very basic level. What are the different stages of the MIPS pipeline? We said that there are five stages: fetch, decode, ALU, memory, and write back. It's very important to know this, because all our discussions for next several hours will depend on this knowledge. The five stages, we'll just refer that in the memory stage this happened, but you should know that is the fourth stage, things like that. And sometimes even you might be asked in interviews and so on that, can you just tell them about the MIPS pipeline or the different stages and so on. So that way it is very important to understand the stages, and as I said that we will look more detail what exactly are the activities carried out during this. So this is a slightly more elaboration of the MIPS pipeline. So during the instruction fetch, we need to access the memory to load the instruction, and we need an order here in the instruction fetch to update the PC. So you would need a separate order compared to the order that is there in the ALU, isn't it? Otherwise there will be structural hazard. Is that clear? Okay. Instruction decode stage, it needs to access the register file for reading operands, and it needs an order to compute the potential branch target. We'll see this in more detail, because some of the instruction after decoding, see, it might be an ordinary instruction, ALU instruction and so on, but it might be a branch instruction. So we need to compute that if after the branch, where it will jump, what is the address to which it will jump. The execute stage needs the ALU, memory stage needs to access the memory, load, store and so on. The write back stage, it needs to access the register file for writing the results, the destination registers. So if we can imagine, these are the different stages: fetch, decode, execute, memory, write back. So from the instruction cache, the fetch unit gets the instruction. The register file, from this the decode unit gets the operand, executes, the memory unit accesses the data cache, and at the same time an access to instruction cache is will be occurring, and the same cycle, the memory unit might be accessing the data cache for a different instruction. Does that appear all right? Okay. And the write back unit, which produces the result, writes the result to the register file. Is this picture clear enough? Because many times you would have to fall back and remember about this picture. There are the caches accessed by the fetch unit, the data cache by the memory unit. The fetch unit accesses the instruction cache, then the decode unit accesses the register file, execute unit doesn't access anything, just does the ALU operation, memory unit accesses data cache, write back unit stores the result in the register file. So if we look in slightly more detail, we'll see that instruction fetch actually consists of two sub pages. One would be translate the virtual address using the TLB. We know from a first level course that the address that these processors deal with are the virtual addresses, right? And what is the role of the TLB and so on, we know from a first level course. Those who are not able to recollect, please brush up your knowledge. We are not going to discuss about that in this course, otherwise we will never be able to complete this course, right, if we start discussing TLB and things like that. So please, if there are few who don't remember about what is a TLB, what is its role and so on, please brush up, because we will keep on referring like that. And then access the instruction cache using the physical address that was generated. So that is the instruction fetch. Now the instruction decode, I am sorry, I just wrote here RD, so the instruction decode. So here decode instruction, then fetch the operand, read the register file. If it is a branch, then generate target address. During the third stage, the execute stage or the ALU stage, we'll have again two sub pages. Start the ALU operation. If a branch, check branch condition. Finish the ALU operation. If it is a load store, see, this is possibly the answer question that somebody was asking. If it is a load store instruction, add base register to the offset to form the effective address and translate to virtual address, right? So during the execution stage for the load store, see, if it is a ALU operation, the ALU operation occurs. For branch instruction, the branch condition checking occurs, and for the load store instructions, the base register is added to the offset to form the effective address and it is translated to virtual address, and the virtual address is translated. Sorry,
in ID case, branch address is already generated. In next case, AP case, see, branch condition, what does it mean?
See, the target case, depending on the branch condition, either it will be the next instruction which is executed or the target address that will be executed. See, just imagine that if the branch condition is false, then no branch will take place. But suppose branch takes place, where it will be branch? We have to compute. So the branch condition will be evaluated in the ALU stage. But the target address, see, in this MIPS architecture, we will see that in the other processors, very different things occur. We will look at the Pentium, we will see that their number of stages are very different, the kind of work they do is also very different. But here they thought that this is the way to balance the work per stage. Roughly, the stages are balanced, and this is how they balance. They first generate the target address for branch instructions, and then they check the branch condition, and if the branch condition is true, then the fetch will operate the target address, right? If it is false, then the target address is ignored, it will just keep on fetching as usual.
Sir, in ALU, the second phase.
Yes.
There is a displacement address. Operand is not in here.
Yes.
Then in that case only the operand is reading and also executed the.
No, no. See, if you recollect what we discussed earlier, the addressing needs. So that there are only two. The immediate and the displacement. That's how it is. So in the displacement, that's how the memory operand will be. And this is how it is computed, that the base register is added to the offset to form the effective address for getting the operand. Remember,
in that same case, that will be executed, instruction will be executed with that operand.
We showed that diagram, no? Didn't you see? Just remember this, that in the execute stage, we are finding the address, operand address, for memory operands, and we have a stage here where the data cache will be accessed. Just remember this. It will be needed in our subsequent discussions also, that in execute stage we don't access any cache or register.
So then if the operand is not yet inside CPU,
yes,
the instruction add or subtract, it will be executed next.
Sorry, can you please elaborate your question?
Sir, you have told that in execute phase, there is no reading writing memory.
Exactly.
Yeah. if he has not yet get the operand.
Register operand.
Yeah.
No, register
every
operand.
If it is by displacement.
There is no memory operand, excepting for the load store. That it's a register, register operand. All operands are in register.
Oh, yes.
Well,
you don't displacement about the register type.
Yeah, so that is as far as the memory operands are concerned. But we are using that, what I said is that we are using the displacement to generate register indirect addressing, right, and absolute addressing. So in the memory stage, access the data cache for the data operands, return data from the data cache and check tags parity, right, whether it is all right. Then in the write back stage, write register file for both memory and other instruction, memory load store and other kinds of instructions, update the destination register. There is only single phase. So you might say that see, it does not appear to be very balanced, but that is how it was designed. We will see other ways of designing. But as we were remarking some time back, that the floating point operations, they appear to be not a very good fit for the instruction pipeline, because imagine the execute stage will take very long time for the floating point instructions. So the pipeline will become very imbalanced if you handle them in the same instruction pipe. But again, you will have to handle that in the same instruction pipe. So how do you do that? Now let's look at how it is done. It is impractical to expect MIPS floating point operations to complete in one or two cycles, because as we are saying that floating point operations typically take long time compared to just one or two cycles. So the solution that they proposed was the floating point instructions should execute on the same pipeline as the integer, but only thing is that the execution cycle may be repeated as many times for a floating point operation. So execution integer just completes like this, but if it is a floating point, it just keeps on executing cycle after cycle in the same unit until it graduates. Of course, there is a bit of hardware complexity here. Similarly, the floating point multiplication, floating point addition, division, and so on. For each of them, they have a separate unit, and an instruction might repeat number of times before it can graduate. So essentially, they are using the same pipe, but for floating point units, the execution unit is executed for multiple cycles. The MIPS could achieve a CPI of 1, as we had already mentioned, that one instruction could be completed every cycle. And to improve the performance further, how do you see if it is completing once every cycle? So what can you do more? How can you improve the performance further? Actually, there are two ways. One is the superscalar approach and the other is super pipelined approach. Let's just look at very basics of this, as we have more detailed discussion coming up later. In a superscalar, we replicate the pipeline stages. So there are multiple instruction fetch, instruction decode, execute, and so on. Replicate each pipeline stage so that two or more instructions can proceed simultaneously. That's the superscalar approach. Here we will issue more than one instruction depending on the order of superscalar processing. I might execute two instructions per cycle, four instructions per cycle. So the degree of superscalar execution, or the order, says how many instructions can be executed per cycle. If the degree of the superscalar processing is 2, we can execute 2 instructions per cycle. The degree is 4, we can execute 4 instructions per cycle. The other approach that we can use to improve the performance of the MIPS is to use super pipeline. So here we can split the pipeline stage into further stages, so that the degree of concurrency can improve. So even though we are not adding extra hardware, unlike the superscalar approach, we can achieve higher speed up. We'll just look at these two approaches in more detail. So this is just a conceptual view of how a superscalar processing will work. The instruction fits for four instructions occurring simultaneously, four instructions for the decode. So this is a different pipeline. We'll look at the Pentium pipeline and so on later on. But right now, let's not get worried about what are the UV, etc. The idea is that we are able to execute four instructions at the same time, or there are multiple pipeline stages. We have replicated the pipeline stages. So we will look at more details of the instruction hazards, the instruction pipeline hazards, and how to overcome. We just till now looked at some very basic definitions and so on. What is a hazard? What are the different types of hazards and so on? We said that interlocking is the hardware solution to hazards and is inefficient. There has to be better solutions, and we didn't discuss about what is the better solution. We're just going to do that next. So to summarize, we saw that RISC architecture style saves chip area that is used to support more registers and cache. So this is how it get higher performance. And the other thing is instruction pipelining. We had seen that three main types of parallelism: instruction level, thread level, and process level parallelism. Two main types of parallel computers, SIMD and MIMD, which are going to discuss. Instruction pipelines are found in almost all modern processors. Exploit instruction level parallelism, transparent to the programmers, and we saw that hazards is possibly the biggest problem as far as pipeline efficiency is concerned. Unless we have a good solution to hazards, pipeline will be almost useless. And in the next lecture, we shall examine hazards in more detail, and we'll see how to resolve hazards. Okay, thank you.